This is the second part of the Creative Activism webinar that we run as a Disruption Network Club in collaboration with AskNet and Rogue. And as Disruption Network Club, here today there is also Sabina Bertucci that was running the first part of the Creative Activism webinar last time.
Hello.
Hello. If you remember, we do a short recap of last webinar. I don't know how many of you were there. Maybe you can write in the chat, I was there or I wasn't, just to have an idea of how many people also have been following the first part to see if we are on the same page with the things we have been discussing. So you're welcome to write in the chat if you have been in the first part or not. It's not important, it's just to me to understand which kind of discourse and things are already shared. So today we will have the presentation of Stella Nianzi that will talk about her digital activism actions. Then we will have a few minutes, 10 minutes for a question and answer with Stella Nianzi. And after we will go on discussing possibilities for sharing and cooperate and collaborate with what we call convivial technologies. So we will also understand what do we mean with this term. And in the past webinar, we have been discussing the meaning of the term hacker. So yes, someone was there, like Stefan and Suzanne, who wasn't. Okay, I think maybe mostly of you haven't been part of the first webinar, but we will anyway collect things together. So we discussed the meaning of the term hacker, but also today we will dig a little bit more into the concept and the meaning of hacking. We saw, thanks to Sabina's presentation, examples of what do we mean with the creative activism. So both actions in the street and online. There was a special guest, Brian Bamanyaya, who showed us his self-made music tools and instruments. And from his presentation, we went on discussing the importance to develop our own technology locally. And today we will see a little bit more why this is important and what do we mean with this. So in this webinar, we will learn from Stella Nianzi's experience in digital activism. We will go deeper to see what does it mean to be an hacker. And why it's important to understand how the technologies with which we work are designed and why. And we will see what do we mean with the convivial technologies. And of course, we will also see a certain number of tools that digital tools that we can use to cooperate, collaborate, and protect ourselves. And these links will remain for you after the webinar. So let me check in the chat. Andrew is here for the first time as well. Also, Denaya. And Sabina, of course, was here last time. And you are all welcome. Thank you for introducing you. We will have after the presentation of Stella, more time to talk a little bit about each other. So now it's my honor. I'm really glad to introduce Stella Nianzi. Some of you may already know her. She's an Ugandan academic, activist, and artist. She's now living in Germany with a scholarship in the Writers in Exile program. She also has a PhD in medical anthropology, and her research focuses on family planning, sexual subcultures, masculinities, and queer African studies. She self-identifies as a radical queer African feminist scholar and activist. And also Stella, she has been arrested and sentenced to 18 months in maximum security prison for her activist action. She does social media activism against menstrual poverty and against femminicide in Uganda. So I think I'm really curious to hear from her and from her experience, and I'm really glad to pass the word and the presentation to Stella, who is here with us. Hello.
Right, thank you very much. It's wonderful to be with you all. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Right, so my name is Stella Nyanzi. I'll just get my slides going and share. Right. Can you see me?
Yes, we can
Good, very
see you
good.
and we can
So
see the slides.
I begin with a picture of myself. As I've been introduced, I'm a poet currently. I mean, I'm an academic, I'm all those other things, but currently I live in Germany as a poet who's a scholarship holder of the Writers in Exile program. And the book No Roses from My Mouth is an important book I wrote when I was in prison because of my Facebook work. My book is not accessible in Uganda, but I can share a link. It is accessible online free of charge to everybody. And one of the things I use the internet for is to spread my work free of charge to people. And in addition to being a poet, I'm a street protester. And sometimes I have to go to the streets. I've had to go to the streets of Uganda. In this case, I was with students of Makerere University marching to our parliament. Sometimes we cannot access the streets and we have protests in buildings. In this case, we were inside a hotel room where we had the media and we had Twitterati, people tweeting and Facebooking on our behalf. And sometimes I also protest inside spaces close to power. In the third photograph, I show a protest I organized with women during COVID times when we were not allowed to have meetings and we were close to a court which was trying protesters who had been protesting for food. I think for me, I have also protested against people with power, such as the police. And many people wonder, why do I resort to digital activism if I can go to the streets, to spaces, and we have creatively fashioned protest spaces even when we didn't have access to public streets and places of power. And for me, often it's been because of the danger that comes with the police. And when I'm asked, why do you do digital activism? Sometimes I also ask myself, why? Is it easier? Is it better? Is it more effective? And I think that part of the work that I have done will kind of explain. I'm going to use photographs because they're easier to work with. During the COVID-19 lockdown in Uganda that was severe, there was a food pandemic alongside the COVID-19 epidemic. Our government had promised to give food to poor people, pregnant mothers, and unemployed dwellers in the capital cities, but they were not. A number of my friends came to ask me for food. I didn't have enough food as well. I had just been released from prison and I had children to feed. And so I mobilized in my room space with papers and asked my children to write protest messages. Here is a photo of me in my library. My daughter took my messages, which I put on my Facebook timeline and asked people to translate for me. And then I invited poor women to come to the to a court session when there was severe curfew and there was no permission to get out of our homes to walk. I invited them to come and attend a case hearing, and I asked them to bring their pots and their pans, and I said I would bring a drum. As we were starting to begin the protest, police people came, and sadly, as the leader, they came and took me away. But in terms of effectiveness, at least using social media, I had been able to successfully reach out to poor women, students who are in university hostels, and we mobilized and got to a court premises. Although I was taken away, there are a number of pictures of this protest that can be found on the internet already, right? And I was dragged away by six people and the protest ended because the leader had been taken away. However, on social media, a new protest of free Dr. Stella Nyanzi began when I was in the coolers. I want to talk a bit about a number of different protests I have organized. Because of time, I may not go through all of them. I have talked about the food protest, and as people will notice, it wasn't hashtag. There was no hashtag mobilizing people online. However, the others that I will talk about have all had hashtags around which we organized. The Pads for Girls UG is a sanitary pad, menstrual hygiene pad, campaign that I organized under a hashtag in response to President Yoweri Museveni's failure to fulfill a promise that he made during his election campaigns in 2016 to provide sanitary pads, school books, exercise books, scholastic materials, pens, etc. to poor students. And he told voters in the Northern Uganda district, if they voted for him, he would provide these for his for poor school girls who often had to miss school when they were menstruating because they didn't have protection. Now, when he went to power, he sent his wife, who had been appointed the Minister of Education, to go to Parliament and say there was no money for sanitary pads. And I thought, what? Where are the women? Where are the menstruators? How can we all keep quiet? And so I mobilized people, called them to collect, fundraise money. We would use the money to buy. Okay, can somebody please mute themselves? And so I mobilized people to fundraise, and every day I was posting on Facebook and Twitter around a hashtag. We gave them mobile money numbers to send mobile money to us. And I promised that all the money we collected, we would buy sanitary pads, reusable sanitary pads, and disposable sanitary pads, and take them to students. And here I share a picture of our first school we went to in rural Uganda. We can see happy students who received their materials. Part of the people who responded to my call were called Kuchu Times, a public media, social media, LGBTIQ campaign group, who came and worked with me around working with a hashtag, mobilizing, using internet collectives. And they were mainly interested in working with schools and ensuring dignity in education. So the public media, through this group, joined the campaign. We were able to reach both Muslim school children, because Muslim Supreme Council women joined our campaign. I was able to go physically to public media stations out of this call. And I want to say that the most important aspect from this particular call is the ability to fundraise. What I share now is a fundraiser that I held with Rotary Club of Kampala Metropolitan in a posh hotel room. Many people who wanted to participate did not want to be seen physically participating with us. They wanted to give us money, but they did not want to physically associate with the campaign. because of the name calling I was doing online to the president and his wife. And so one of them called Victor, his name is usually put on these, organized a GoFundMe page asking people to donate from $5 all the way to whatever. And the campaign was run by Victor for pads, hashtag pads for Uganda. So a different hashtag to the one we were using. We were using hashtag pads for girls, UG. And by the time the campaign was closed, it closed down after about a month. We had been able to raise $5,852 using the GoFundMe page, right? And I think in terms of social media activism, we see the importance of digital tools to collaborate with. Victor was based in Canada. I have never met him physically. He brought his skill of running this GoFundMe page, mediating and negotiating with tax systems in Canada. And he was able to get this money, which he relayed to us, and we were able to reach at least six districts and almost 1,200 young girls in Uganda received sanitary pads from our campaign. I will now move to another campaign called hashtag Rot at MISA. MISA is Makerere Institute of Social Research. Actually, before I do that, I will go to the Women's Lives Matter, hashtag Women's Lives Matter, which is a campaign that I run in response to increasing numbers of young women, especially poorer women from the lower economic groups, getting kidnapped. Their kidnappers reaching out to their families and asking for high sums of ransom. After the ransoms were paid or the money was not able to be collected, so they were unpaid, the kidnappers would then murder the young women, throw them in public spaces with their legs spread open and either bottles or sticks inserted into their bodies. Now, there was no accountability, no prosecution, no trials, no convictions, and the number of bodies lying on the streets, in public spaces, by the well, in the districts of Kampala, Wakiso, and Mpiji, which are quite central and close to the hearts of power in Uganda, these bodies were not being accounted for. And so I organized a campaign around women lives mattering. The first thing I did was to meet with women, and we were scared. So I said we were going to march in the streets of Uganda, of Kampala, with coffins, 42 coffins signifying 42 women. I went to Uganda Human Rights Commission, and prior to going, I called activists to come and meet with us, and we would share materials, prepare materials, then we'd go into the street. At the Uganda Human Rights Commission, I was halted and refused, denied entry. The Human Rights Commissioners called the police, which is opposite from their premises, called the police, and a number of protesters with whom I was were arrested. In response to this, I went to the villages then, because I wasn't able to mobilize in the city. I went to the villages and again mobilized border men, public motorbike men, and we went to a school, and we were able also to try and get discussions with the police, asking them why they arrested us. And I was able, through the negotiations and the build-up from protesters, to get a meeting and an audience with the Assistant Inspector General of Police in Uganda. Up to that time, we had been denied permission to have the protest march happening in Kampala. And so I began to work with artists, and they began to produce materials to say, we are going to have the march in Kampala City. During the organization, I, my driver, and lover were arrested at least four different times. However, the pressure from different activists ensured that although we were arrested and the protest had been called off, we were able to march in the streets of Kampala with a number of elite women from civil society organizations. And I think what was most striking for me was that the ambassador, the American ambassador of Uganda at that time, and the French ambassador to Uganda came and participated in a protest. Now, I had written a Facebook message saying we are inviting white bodies with power to come and stand as shields, come and shield us from the police who are going to attack us. I didn't realize that my Facebook post would be shared over and over again until ambassadors got the Facebook post. It was tweeted by the American ambassador that time, who was called Deborah, and she mobilized white bodies. I don't know who these women were. They came with their husbands and their children to the protest. And I think part of what that showed me is the ability of the internet to reach both the elite as well as people of power. And so again, very much art was central to the sort of work that we did. I want to talk a bit about checking on time. Yes, 5 more minutes. Another protest that I conducted, and this one for me was a very feminist, very radical protest. I am known to be a nude protester in my country. I throw off my clothes and speak truth to power, because there are moments when words and petitions cannot work. Diplomacy cannot work. Wrote at MISA, Makerere Institute of Social Research, is a protest that I led. This time I had hoped to mobilize young women and men who are students at the PhD at Makerere Institute of Social Research, where I was teaching. However, because of fear of institutional backlash, many were not able to participate. I was locked out of my office in spite of a number of negotiations over a number of years. And I gave my supervisor, my superior, the director of the institution, an ultimatum to open. I wrote a Twitter message to him the first time I used Twitter, and I say to him to open my office by Monday. So he shut my office on Friday. I ordered him through a tweet to open my office. If he did not, I was going to undress myself in protest. And undressing would mean that I'm undressing the rot at this institute. Now, on Monday morning, I went to my place of work. My office was still locked, and so I occupied the building, threw off my clothes, and the first picture that I shared is a picture that I posted on my Facebook timeline saying, I found my door closed, I have undressed in protest, fuck Makerere Institute, I'm doing rot at Makerere. I had invited the press to come and participate and record me and share my message with the rest of Uganda, and they refused. However, when I posted about 10 minutes after posting my first nude picture, there were so many press, the Daily Monitor, which I'm sharing there, the television. I was on the television, I think, for the whole week in all my nude glory. And the other thing I want to talk about is that artists took interest in the internet productions, and they produced their own imagery, including a whole exhibition that eventually got to win. But all this work was taken from the protest presentations that were captured and stored and curated online, because most of the people who produced the art thereafter were not even at Makerere Institute of Social Research physically. Cartoons were produced, etc., etc. And part of what I'm trying to say is that my protest that began physical but was amplified online has had productive and generated productive ideas among a number of creative dissident artists in Uganda. The very last protest I want to talk about is Justice for Tegu, a young man who was murdered by police and security officers in Uganda during curfew times in the lockdown. Now, instead of the police owning up, they accused him or claimed, alleged that he was mentally ill. Student protesters began to call for other students to join the hashtag Justice for Tegu. asked them to take photos saying no to police brutality and have an internet protest, have an internet demonstration. In addition to joining the internet protest, we felt it was important to go and march onto the streets. And so we issued a call saying on Monday 11th, July 2020, we were going to march to the Parliament of Uganda with our protest placard. So we began online organizing, went to Parliament, and ended up detained by the police. And the very last thing in the very last minutes for me is to say that while protests have been very effective in terms of mobilizing and organizing, in my case, there's also been a cost. The most severe cost for me has been that I've been charged at least two times, not just arrested. I've been arrested over 20 times, maybe 26, because of protesting, but I've been charged specifically for computer misuse. Under the Computer Misuse Act of 2011, I was charged for cyber harassment and offensive communication against the president in 2017 and in 2018. And I have mental examination, an application to be subjected to involuntary mental examination because of the audacity with which I produce some of my protest work online. And so I will end by saying for me, there have been a number of reasons why digital activism, why I do it. Some of them have been shared: fundraising, amplification, solidarity, anonymity, etc., etc. But I look forward to hearing some feedback from other people who may want to ask questions, may want to challenge, etc., etc. And I think for me, it's just an example of how digital activism can be done, how it's both for me on the streets and off the streets, and also how it's very empowering, but can also have a cost that could be disempowering. Thank you very much. I thank you for the time.
Thank you very much, Stella. Thank you very much for this amazing and fast walk through your the actions and the digital activist actions you have been through. I would like to invite the participant to make any questions that may pop up in your mind. At the same time, I would like to ask you that you said that you have been arrested many, many times, but the reason why you have been charged in prison was because of was under the Computer Act. Is it right? Did I understand?
Yes, I have been arrested very many times. I have only been charged and tried two times, and it was under the Computer Misuse Act. Other times I have been charged but never prosecuted. The charges are dropped for lack of evidence. But
Okay.
the second time I was actually convicted to 18 months in prison because of a poem that I wrote and shared online.
Okay, share it on Facebook, on social media, or share it on cioè, where did you share the poem? It was shared on one of so a social media
Social
platform.
media, Facebook for me is my most important platform because of the verbosity. I like many words. I like photos as well. Later on, I learned Twitter, and I think in Uganda, maybe similar to South Sudan, that Facebook tends to be for the majority of us, and Twitter is very elitist. And now Instagram and TikTok are for much younger groups. And so for me at the time, it was Facebook, but the poem got shared all over. It's now everywhere.
Okay, and I have another question. I was wondering, especially regarding the food protest. You said that you have been dragged away by cops, as we also saw in the pictures. But you have been able to mobilize people to go and protest. So the digital actions you do them in collaboration with a group of people as a starting point that help you spreading the messages or help you writing on social media when some of you is no more able to do it as it's arrested. So the question is, do you coordinate your social media actions with other fellows, or you leave everything to the spontaneous action of the net?
I mean, that's a beautiful question. I think for me, there has been a learning curve. When I started my initial protests, I was relying on my followers and friends or whatever they're called, to follow through when they said, "We shall come and participate, we shall come and participate." Later on, I realized that 1,000 people might promise to come and join the action, whatever it is, but only two turn up. And then I formed what we call the Women's Protest Working Group, which combines women who are online, combines lawyers, combines doctors, combines people who cannot come to the streets but have access to offices that have the internet. And so they can tweet for us, and we call them our Twitterati fe or feminist ninjas online, because even when they're not on the ground, they carry the message on. And I learned, especially when my phone is taken away from me by the police, it's important to have other people who can access my Facebook timeline. And so now every time we're organizing, there's a group of women, at least, sometimes five, the whole working group of women's protest working group is about 24 women, but depending on availability, sometimes we're five, sometimes we're 12. And those ones now carry the message, but we don't have we're not formally tied to each other.
Okay, thank you very much. We also have a question from the chat from Matthew, who is asking he would like to know something regarding your harassment at the Juba International Airport.
Right, so I very quickly, briefly, one of the things that I do is to use my Facebook timeline even today, even this year, although I'm now in exile. I use my timeline to report about what's happening. I got to Juba Airport. I had two laptops. One was brand new. I was taking it for a friend. The other one was my old laptop at the Juba International Airport. The immigration police required me to pay. I think they asked for $400, and I thought, no way. And I created a storm, and they called me mad, and they tried to arrest me. Part of the reputation of being who I am, there were police officers, high-ranking police officers, who came and said, let her go. And so immediately they released me. I shared photographs of my arrested self, of my, when I was arrested, I collapsed and passed out, and somebody took a picture and sent it to my WhatsApp group. And so I shared it when I was leaving Sudan a week later, which generated a huge discussion, a huge debate on South Sudanese radios and televisions. And a number of people insulted me. So there's backlash and, hate speech and cyber harassment. But I was able to get an audience with the minister of South Sudan, who said, what happened? And this came from just two Facebook posts writing about the harassment that I faced and sharing photographs, right? So maybe I did not change anything in South Sudan at the Juba International Airport, but I wrote about it, had a debate. I was hounded by journalists from South Sudan for 2 weeks. Every day they wanted an interview, and I say to them, go to my Facebook timeline. I don't know South Sudan that well, but what was able to happen from that Juba International Airport experience was a very live example, classic example of how, for me, social media works. And although I didn't have a regular audience of South Sudanese, I now have about 200 new followers who are of South Sudan, either origin or residence.
Thank you, Stella. Do we have any other question?
I can have one.
Yes, please.
So, hello, Stella, and very nice to meet you, and congratulations for your outstanding career as an activist. My question is more on, let's say, personal side. I am a part of Disruption Network, which is an organization that works with activists and whistleblowers, and especially during our last conference, it was interesting to see an entire part of the conference focused on the personal side, the spiritual side of the activist. So I would like to ask you what kind, so you have been arrested over 20 times. I mean, you have a campaign and so important and on so important topics, and then I was wondering if you can share what kind of personal strengths or spiritual strengths you actually found especially useful to cultivate in order to grow your capacity in undertaking and sustaining such a radical and intense activist work. And the other question is perhaps related also about the hate speech that you might have encountered online in your online activism, and if you have a take and what is an advice or what did you find useful for yourself to sustain this type of role in society? Thank you.
Right, so it's 11 past 4. So maybe I'll take just 2 minutes. Yeah, is that okay?
Yeah. Sure, feel free.
Yes. Okay. So I was raised Christian, married a Muslim. Today, I think I'm agnostic. And so in terms of religiosity, I don't know if I'm religious, right? That's the first thing just to say and put out there. I think in terms of my own radical strength, I draw a lot of strength and sense of being and fortitude, especially when I'm down, from the examples of other women who've gone before me, especially those who are doing amazing work before the internet, you know, women whose lives were put at risk even in harder ways than mine. That's one. That there's a lot of feminist giants on whose shoulders I step, and reading their stories gives me encouragement. And I think two for me is my children. I'm very much driven by having a story to tell my children, or the pride my children will one day have when they one day have kids or a new generation, and they say there was all of this happening that was negative, but our mother, your grandmother, contributed in this way. And so I think for me, the need to be an ancestor of sorts, to join the other ancestors for future, to be one of those who passed on the baton, that the baton does not end with me, I think is really important. And sometimes I want to give up, and then I look at my daughter and her friends, whether they're in Africa or they're here in Germany, and I think, no way, no way, we can't all keep quiet. And so there's that history, but also very much the personal, that I'm very much invested in this. If it doesn't change, if the problem doesn't change, and I fold my hands and I don't participate in whichever way, it doesn't have to be the most powerful way, there's a need for me to participate and change things, because change is possible. The question about hate speech is a really dear one to me, especially when one works from stances where they are the minority and opposite to those in power. I am a queer rights activist from Uganda. We have a death penalty for gay men and lesbian women. So a lot of the hate speech, or I'm a feminist who works with patriarchs, I'm an opposition political party member who is against a militant authoritarian government that has a large following. And the hate speech can be, sometimes it's very personal. I can deal with broad structural accusations, the most damaging to me is when threats are made to my children. When men say, we shall sodomize your boys, we shall rape your boys through the anus. Sometimes it's that grotesque. When they threaten to take away my daughter and send back particular body parts to me, that is very personal, because it's not just about me, the individual actor. It's also about those who are close to me, immediate family. Sometimes it's been my comrades and colleagues who I work with. How I've dealt with that sometimes, it's when it's personal and they're attacking me and calling me ugly and old and all of those things, one can get counseling and deal with self-care and take time off. I think the harder one for me has been when it's about innocent others in my life, right? And I had initially thought that I shouldn't share about my children or expose them, but I found that publicizing who my children are and sharing about them gives some level of protection for me and for my children, especially when the threats and hate speech were not just threats. When they began to become actualized, it was important that other adults online knew what my children looked at. And then I'd get messages saying, hey, we see your son with this adult. Hey, we see the police at your school. Hey, this is happening, right? And so while hate speech, people can deal with hate speech, I think for me, the hardest layer to deal with are threats to innocent minors and innocent lovers and family members close to me. When it's extended and the threats are extended to them, I still don't quite know how to cope, because then it becomes very personal.
Thank you, Stella. This is very hard. So thank you for these big shoulders. And Stefan Kovacs, he has a question, please.
Yeah, I just want, before Stella leaves or parts off, first of all, I just wanted to give you a big, big thank you for joining us. I really, really appreciate it, as do the team here at Rogue, and a very big hello also from Glenn, who for technical reasons couldn't join us. And I just wanted to point out that one of the participants in the webinar here doesn't have her camera on. Sometimes it's a connectivity issue. Is Yina Yenke from the organization called Go Girls ICT, based in Juba, and Yina, who I would also consider to be an activist and a hacktivist, is. Doing great work with Go Girls ICT, dealing with a lot of the issues that you brought up in terms of supporting girls and young women in a very, very difficult and obviously also patriarchal environment. Also connecting access to technology, access to communication, access to information for young girls and women who normally cannot get easy access to it. So this issue also, very parallel to what you're talking about, is the basic access to these means of communication, means of technology that are often blocked by, society, our men around us, and so on, is a constant battle and requires also creative and hacktivist means to get around them, because the usual ways of trying to get that access often don't work. So the more hints we can get, or they those communities can get on how to do that and get your voice and your ability to communicate and connect out there, the better. And I think you gave us a few little hints and some brilliant examples today. So again, I very much appreciate that. So thank you on behalf of AskNet. We will be sharing also the webinar with people who could not join today. So thank you. Anyways, it's not the end of the webinar. I just wanted to throw that in there in case you need to go. And I pass the microphone back to Agnese and Sabina and everyone. And I don't know, maybe Ina wants to say something as well. Anyways, thank you very much.
Hello, Ina, would you like to say something?
Steven! No, I was trying to digest and reflect on what Stella has been doing. I think personally, as a social media person, let me see if I can turn on my camera. Let me see, just a second. Anyways, regardless. So I've been following Stella's work. So silent follower who is always trying to see what's happening within the region. How are women advocating? How are women using these spaces? And yeah, just like the way Steven said, I think for South Sudan, it's a little bit hard, and someone always has to find a way of navigating the waters. Looking at, I think starting with the basic, even looking at how many people can afford to be on these platforms, how many people are even connected. When you look at statistics, it's about 7%. So you realize the biggest percentage, which is 93, are still offline. So that in itself raises the concern that most of the things actually happen on the ground, and most times it happens in a community setting, then it's taken to these platforms to be shared with the world. But from the number of few protests that I've seen being organized within Juba, I think one key element that I observed and noticed, I think it's just us being very patriarchal and people being so patriarchal and so much, especially women, like so much attached to their culture. Even if you see a problem and the women activists go online and they host all these rallies, I think we've seen Crown the Woman doing so many of that. It happens very well. We demand the government to do A, we demand the government to do B, and then the victim comes. It's like the victim comes with a different story. And sometimes it makes, not sometimes, but most times, or in some cases, it even made the women activists almost, I don't want to say, look like liars. And I think that's a very huge struggle that today, you know, there are some cases that are happening in South Sudan, but even no one wants to protest or talk about it. Just a week ago, I went to an event and I learned of this university student because she got married to a political figure. This man didn't want her to continue with her studies because she's a medical student and she's going to take a lot of years. So what the man did, he sent police, her parents were arrested. And when the parents were arrested, of course, the parents had to demand the university to release her. So the entire case ended at the university deciding whether we terminate this girl from continuing with her studies because her husband is a big man, or we let her parents rot in the jail. So this was a case which was shared by one of our friends who's also a lecturer at the university. And she was like, now, in such a case, what do we do? But also, at the same time, this brings us to which kind of laws do we have in place, which was really lacking. And I think at the end of our discussion, I'm just trying to look at different ways of how this case would have been handled very easily, even with so many women advocates in South Sudan. We realize South Sudan even doesn't have, for example, things like family laws that even protect women at, how should I say, that protect women in their homes, that protect married women, all these gaps that are lacking just at the grassroots or community level are just in itself becoming even a hindrance for the women who are supposed to be stepping up and putting their foot forward, saying that we have these issues, this is how they should be, this is how it can be solved, or this is what the law says. So it was interesting listening to you. I've picked quite a number of nuggets of wisdom. And perhaps I think finding all these ways to maneuver, I think we've done that very well with Go Girls. Even if it's a situation that is being thrown at us, we always come in an angle of, look, this is the problem and this is how we should solve the problem. And I think for the number of years we've existed, which is close to 8, it has worked. It's very easy actually for us to go to a room and tell the government, look, it's like this, and it's like, and they say yes, because we realized at first the moment you say, hey, look, there's this gap, it's like people just want to attack you immediately before you even do anything. And of course they have all these measures and ways put into place, but looking at all that, we just realized the only way for us to counter all these things is to come from the angle of, we found out this problem and we felt like this problem could be solved this way, and this actually this solution works. And they're like, oh, and it's always very easy actually for them to buy into the idea just coming from, I think, Go Girls, we are quiet we are quiet, but I think very assertive in a very quiet way, that they get it and they just decide to change in relation to what we want. Yeah, I just felt I should put that out there.
Thank you, Yanni, for your for bringing your experience to us. What we are going to do now is to discuss some tools for cooperate and collaborate online with digital tools. So maybe it's less about mobilizing people and it's more about working to organize the people you have on the ground, that you have in your community. So I will share my screen and go to the second part of this webinar. I think Stella may stay with us, so you are, and we are very glad. So you are all welcome to stop me and make questions, even in the chat or by talking. And I just want to add that in the chat, Matthew said that he thinks there is a lack of role models or mentors like Stella in South Sudan, and we need more of them. And I don't know personally the situation in South Sudan, of course, but I'm sure that more people like Stella are needed everywhere. Okay, so I think I'm sharing my screen. Can you see it? Is it Jared? Yes? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so the first thing I would like to do is to introduce a tool that we can start using now, if you feel like. And this is the URL to reach the tool that Sabina can also pass in the chat. If we go here, this is a pad. It's called Pad, Etherpad. And it's a tool for collaborative writing online. I guess maybe some of you already used it, or is it free to you? Is it new? Make me like a wave or write in the chat just to know how many of you already have been tweaking with this kind of tool, which is very much it's very much handy, is very much useful. It's very simple, but again, it's really a basic tool for collaboration among people online. So it's called the Etherpad, and you can install it in your local server, or you can use public service. And in this pad that will remain even at the end, sorry, of the webinar, there is a list of links where you can find all the resources we are talking about. The interesting characteristic of this pad, of this tool, is that it's secret. This means that Google or any search engine doesn't know it. It means that we can use it to write things that belongs only to us, like the coordination for an action or a text before it become public. So it's a place where only the people I know and the people with whom I'm sharing the link, only those people can enter. But at the same time, there is no login or password. I see that already five of you are inside. And as you can see, it's not needed to add your name, or you can add your name or your nick as you like. So it's totally anonymous, which is helpful in the moment in which you don't want to expose yourself, but you may want to contribute with your words to some collective production. So it's interesting because it's a use of the internet, of the digital technologies that in this case is different from the one that we just saw from Stella example, because it belongs more to the part related to the organization or to the research we do together, more than to the mobilizing part. Even if we will see later how even this tool can become a tool to mobilize people. So it's interesting because it's free and you don't need to write down your name or say who you are. I can see that someone is already writing, and it has got another interesting characteristic, like everyone can write and everyone can also delete. No, I can delete things or I can write things. But if I delete the things that other people wrote, it's possible to go back in the time slider and see whatever was there in the previous version. So even if it's a free and open tool where everyone can make change, it's anyway possible to save everything, so nothing gets lost. It's also possible to download the pad, decide that it's only possible to read. So imagine that you wrote your poem or you wrote your collective call, then you can make it only readable and share it on social media or on your blog, on your website. This is the link to share the pad. Or you can even choose to download, and you can choose how to download, in which format, HTML or plain text or the etherpad way of writing. So it's very, very there are many things you can do with it. So I just leave it to you to play with. Also because now that we introduce it, we will use it to make some a first interaction between us. A first, okay, we've been discussing a lot, but again, a last thing, this pad will disappear in 180 days. If no one write in it for 180 days. So if there are relevant informations for you, like this list of links. You're welcome to download it, maybe as a plain text or whatever. But remember that if no one writes on it, it will disappear. So now I will invite you to write on the pad, or if you don't feel like to write in the chat, what is an hacker for you? Well, if we say the word hacker, what does pop up in your mind? I can see that someone already wrote some definition. Okay, I can write, I wrote it, it's not meaningful, I delete it. And you are welcome to write it down. Let me see if someone is writing in the chat. There is an interesting message for Ian, but it's not now on this. So what we have been discussing, what is an hacker, even in the last webinar. And I think that it's interesting to go back to this term, because it's into the title of the webinar, Creative Activism, and also because there is a lot of different mood, mixed moods towards the world. So for someone, we can see it's a policy changer, which is amazing, because it's something as a definition, because it's something that totally goes away from the digital realm. He's or she is a creative thinker. He or she is a researcher exposing the dark side of technology by speaking the same language. Wow, these are amazing definitions. I'm telling this because I do this kind of game a lot of time in the schools here in Italy, in schools, in different kind of groups with children and adults and parents. And usually the reaction is, no, an hacker is a thief, is dangerous. Usually is always a man, and usually is always a dangerous person. While it's very nice to see that maybe as part of the AskNet community, you have much more in-depth reflection on what is an hacker. An inquisitive person. An hacker can be a problem solver or a problem creator. Exactly, totally true. Depending on the intentional perspective, exactly, this is totally true as well. Because when we talk about hacker, there is always someone who talks about the ethical hacker, the bad hackers, the good hackers. I don't like to make this distinction, but I think that an hacker has got powers, and it depends on how he or she chooses to be in the world. A brave person who breaks into other people's institutional spaces and disrupts the representation of reality. This is really interesting. Also might take away their data. So what I can see from the things you're writing, which is very interesting, is that we all are talking about power. Each sentence, each definition you are using somehow deal with the fact that the hacker has powers. He or she can break into spaces, can choose to take away the data or not. It's creative. So let's see how I can put together all these perspective on being an hacker. And this pad, even if I change the screen, it remains there. So feel free to keep writing or whatever. It's a free space that belongs to us during this webinar and even after. So, yes, as many of you already have been writing, an hacker finds and builds here or has own path. her or his own way to deal with digital worlds. So it's a creative person. And there are specific things that are very important to me that the hacker does. The hacker unpeels layers. It means that the hacker goes beyond to see what lies behind the surface of the technology we use daily. In fact, someone is writing exposing the dark side of technology, no? Or exposing the unknown side by speaking. But let's see what do we mean with this. For example, if we go to this famous website, that maybe you know that google.com. Okay, you know, I think you saw this website already. And what does which kind of feeling this web page gives to you? Usually the answer I get is that it's very clean, no? It's very clean and easy and very simple, no? Tell me if you don't agree, but usually these are the answers that I get, and also the feeling that I have watching this this page. If we go to this page instead, let's do it in English. Compared to the other one, what is the feeling that it gives you? Okay, I can tell the feelings usually that it gives. Of course, it's ordered, it's not chaotic, but it's more, it looks more complex, no? That this one, than the Google one. There are a lot of words, a lot of stuff. Okay, so let's see now what an hacker does. An hacker goes layer, peel off a layer. I'm peeling off a layer. This is what lies behind the Google website, the Google page. This is the page. I peel off a layer. This is what I find. Okay, I can make it bigger, but even if there are coders among you, I really think that you can't read this because it's not just HTML language, but it's obfuscated. It means that it is done in the way that you're not supposed to copy and paste and reproduce the same web page, because it's by the will of Google, it's obfuscated. You can't see how the page is written. You just see a big mess. While if we go on this website and we peel, this is the website of my book. I did it. And if we peel off one layer, this is what we see. And if there is an HTML or a coder among you, it's very easy to read. If there is, if no one of you can write HTML, still you can write, you can read the text. So even if you peel a layer, you see that under the surface it lie there is a text and material that you can use. You can either copy and paste and make a similar website. So there are different philosophies and different attitudes towards the internet that are behind the Google policy and my personal policy or a common person policy, no? Okay, so this is what we mean with unpeel layers. Also notice an hacker notice details, which means that the details make the difference in technology, in digital technology. So I can see the fact that here I can't read, here I can read what I see because of the tag. So notice details is important. Another thing that the hacker does is to use an oblique gaze, which means that we have to look at ourselves and at the technology that we use from outside. We have to observe how do we feel in relationship with the technology to understand how the technology works. So this is the oblique gaze. I watch, but I watch also from a different perspective. So I try to watch myself while I'm interacting with the digital technology, like while I'm interacting with Zoom. How do I feel? Do I feel overexposed? Am I comfortable? Am I not? These are all the things that we as hacker observe. And obviously, an hacker share and collaborate, because it's important to grow new knowledge. It's important to share. This is the only way in which we can create new knowledge. And as we can see, in this case, it's not very much about sharing and collaborate. While here on the pad, this is what we are doing. So this is an hacker. Now, let's see what do we mean with technology of domination. When I use the term we, I mean me and the group of research we do, my work, which is called CIRCE, and I will leave the link to you later. To see what do we mean with technology of domination, first thing I would like to ask you to add on the pad here, to add the write down the digital tools that you like to use. Okay, I prefer Jitsi, but so some of them are already here. So maybe just put a cross near the tools that you like to use. Or if there are any of those in this list, feel free to add your favorite digital tool, the tool that you most often use and that you like to use, not only that you have to use for work, because maybe you use some tools that you dislike, no? So yeah, it's better that we focus on what we do like. So we can see that WhatsApp and Telegram are the most used, that we like are what we mostly like to use. Someone also is using Signal, TikTok, a lot of Google, but maybe it's still the same person because it's the same color. Okay, WhatsApp and Telegram, they look like the tools that are that we mostly like, at least among the people in this webinar. Okay. So each of these tools give us a power. Digital tools, they give us a kind of superpower. Like with Zoom, I can see you and talk to you even if we are hundreds and thousands of kilometers away from each other. So it gives me the superpower of being at the same time in Uganda and in Germany to talk with you. It gives me the superpower of being in different places at the same time. So which superpowers, which powers or superpowers WhatsApp or Telegram or the tools that you better like gives you? Like Jitsi is a kind of Zoom, so I'll write here down. Okay, feel free to write. This doesn't also because anyway, we don't know who you are, so you can write whatever. Okay, telegrams give security, the feeling of security. Yeah, no, it's no question mark. I mean, it's what there is not a good answer or wrong answer. It's the power that you feel that the tool gives to you. So cannot be wrong or right, because it's up to you. So Facebook has the power to reach many people. So it's like a megaphone, we can say, no? It's like amplify the voices, we can say. Google make things, make maths together. ChatGPT also, we have ChatGPT now, yes. Improve written work, so it gives the power of writing better, maybe, no? Brainstorming, okay. Brainstorming with ChatGPT, never did it, interesting. Collaborative writing, okay, so a few things are coming up. Follow the opinion on Twitter, follow opinion leaders, so the ability to listen to many voices at the same time, maybe. This is can be a power. We also are adding Canva. Yeah. Communicate. So, okay, as we can see, now the most we think about it, the more things pop up, powers that we are given by these tools pop up to our mind. This is very interesting, but what we have to remember, this is why we have Spider-Man here. I don't know if you know the famous sentence from the this cartoon that every superpower come with great responsibilities. So we have these powers, but we have the responsibility of the way in which we use these powers. So the question is, how do we use these powers that we gain with these tools that we like to use? This image that you see here now that I'm sharing, I hope that you see it clearly. It's in Italian because it's a picture I took in an Italian secondary school. And it means it's up to you. Dipende da te means it's up to you. So how do you use these powers? It's up to you. And as you can see in the image, we have an angel and a devil. The angel has got a lot of icons from social media. Some of the tools we also listed on the pad. So we have Telegram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube. Even if YouTube, okay, only two of us like it, okay. But if you observe this image, you can also see that the angel and the devil, they have the same, they are made of the same digital tools. So the teachment that we found in this secondary school, it was you can, it depends on how you use your digital tool, how you use these powers, if you become an angel or a devil. I don't know if you all agree on this, but spoiler, I don't agree with this. Why? There are important reason, and this is these are the things I would like very much to share with you now. It's not up to you how you use these digital tools that we mentioned. Zoom, Telegram, Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, each platform is designed in a certain way. If you remember from last webinar, Brian Afrorak was talking about the tools he developed, the music instruments, and he said that the tools, the music tools he found on the market, they don't play some specific sounds of Uganda. And he said that is because it has been made by someone who is not living in Uganda and doesn't know that sounds. So if you want to make a digital musical tool that reproduces the sounds that you are used to listen in your local place, in your country, you have to create it on your own. But why? Also, Sabina was talking about critical engineering last time. So the point is that every tool, and of course also the digital tool, they reproduce the culture of those who created it. So the tools, they have certain limitations and certain features that are embodied into the technical resource. These are called affordances, and we may not realize that they are there. We don't see those affordances because they act not on a cognitive level. For example, in this slide, there is the image of a battle, no? And I'm taking the hand that is taking the battle. You see the way in which the battle is made in a way in which that allows, that invite the hand to grab in that way. This is an affordance. It means that the tools are made in a way that invite you to a certain use. And this is a first reason why it doesn't depend on how you use it. For example, this battle, you can use this battle taking it from the bottom, but it's less comfortable. So it requires much more effort for you. So why should I? It's better to take it as it's designed for. And this is what we call affordance. So if you have any question, I don't know if I'm going too fast or saying things that are not really immediate. So please interrupt me, raise your hand, write in the chat, write in the pad, make noise or tell me. Another thing is that the environment and also the digital environment that are designed by engineers, coders, they exercise a gentle push. So they not only invite you to grab and to have a certain use, but they also create a set where you behave in a certain way without knowing it. So this is a very interesting example, and you may are wondering why there is this image of a male toilet. I'm sorry, maybe it's not so nice, but it's a very important image for understanding what do we mean with nudge. If you see here in the middle, there is a fly. This black thing is a fly, okay? Okay, it's a fake fly, it's not a real fly. The point is that usually male, I'm not a male, but usually male, it seems that they have problem to pee in the right direction. And so there are always all these banners. Please pay attention while you pee. Please don't make a mess in the toilet or you are forbidden to pee in the wrong way. So there are a lot of different messages for guys. But It doesn't work because prohibition doesn't work. The kind invite to be more caring doesn't work. So what did they did? This is in Netherlands autogrill on the autobahn. They put a fake fly in the toilet and guys, they try to hit the fly with their pee. And in this way, they reduce the amount of chaos in the toilet. But no one is telling them to behave in a certain way. They are gently, in a kind way, invited to behave in a certain way by the setting, by the space, by the way in which the space is designed. Why am I saying all these things about bottles and toilets? It's because, even if it sounds weird, the same happens on with the digital tools. The exact same things happens on Facebook, Telegram, TikTok, or on Zoom. For example, Zoom invites you to open your camera, because if the camera is closed, you are like, in this moment, I am a black box. So I feel weird, not very comfortable. So maybe I should open my camera. But if I open my camera, maybe I don't feel comfortable because I'm not public person, and now I can't open my camera anymore. Okay, I did it. Sorry. So even the digital tools have affordances and nudge, and these affordances and nudge are designed into the tools by the people who wrote the tools, who coded the tools, who designed the platforms that we use. So this is from my book, a sentence. This is the cover of my book. Technology are tools. They are ways of relating. They realize worldviews. They depend on interactions, and all technologies embody, incorporate, and tend to evolve and take to the extreme the ideologies of the people who created them. So this is the point. I don't know if you want to comment somehow, and we can go on seeing what do I mean with the convivial technologies related to technologies of domination. Because with domination, I mean exactly this. I mean technologies that create a set around us to behave. Of course, we can use them in different ways, but this requires an effort. And maybe it's interesting to put this effort somewhere else, maybe to create our own technologies. So what I would like to do now is to give you an overview of what are these technologies that we can imagine. Of course, we can think about mobilizing thousands of people with the technologies that we may imagine, because the technologies of domination are everywhere. So as Stella does, if you want to reach out thousands of people, you need to use the tools of domination, because everyone has got Facebook or Twitter, but not everyone is on a Etherpad. But again, it's important for us to be aware of these differences. This is why I'm talking about this. So conviviality, what I do mean with the conviviality? I don't know if you have this term somehow. I mean, it's an English term, but in Italian, è convivialità. So in Italian is very similar. I don't know if you have a similar term in your own languages. So I explain it a little bit more because for Italians it's very easy to understand, but maybe in other language not. So conviviality means to be all together and to share something. And usually it's food. Usually is when you are all together sharing foods and having good time. This is conviviality usually. It's a party. It's a kind of party. Conviviality is a dynamic, plural, and changeable. This means that it's made by a lot of people and it's in a continuous transformation. Conviviality is not a chaos, but is neither order. There is not a rigid schedule, it's in constant transformation, it's an aware transformation. So imagine you are in a big table or in a big dinner with a lot of people and someone has to bring the bread, someone has to bring the vegetables, so you have to coordinate a little bit, but no one is forced to bring something. So this is not chaos, neither order. It's negotiation, a kind of, it's to negotiate, to talk with the people that participate to the feast and negotiate. And of course it's not done in solitude. So a convivial technology has a specific characteristic. It's situated, which means that it assumes and declares its situated position in the world. What do I mean? I mean that Mark Zuckerberg, when he talks of Facebook, he doesn't really situate the platform. He doesn't really say, hey, look, guys, I made this platform to make money out of your attention. He doesn't say that. He says, I make this technology to have let people be in contact with people of their life. Okay, this is a byproduct, but he doesn't say explicitly where he is situated. I made this technology in the Silicon Valley for people that wants to make money. Cioè, I mean, this is a clear statement. But it's not told. While a convivial technology declare the ideology that lies behind its design, so that every one of us is free to use that technology with awareness of where and how it's situated. A convivial technology tends to fair and equal distribution of the shares. It means that the power that this technology gives is shared. It doesn't belongs only to the owner of the platform. And it's free, as a free software. So the code is public. Everyone can modify and improve it because, as we said, an hacker share and collaborate. So it doesn't belong to the lineage of domination, but it belongs to the lineage of freedom, mutual support, mutual aid, even with digital technologies. I don't know if there are any questions, so maybe I'm too fast. No, you're fast was to someone else, okay. So, a person with whom I collaborate from my group, Carlo Milani, wrote a book on convivial technologies. This is a sentence taken from the book, which is entirely available on at this link, but it's in Italian. I'm sorry, we didn't translate it yet, but maybe you can use DeepL or other translation tools if you're curious about it. And what does he say is that we need to devise methods of convivial collaboration. We must learn to select the appropriate characteristic to develop conviviality, both in human beings and technical beings, which means that it's important that we see what we do like we do to do with the digital tools, with the internet. For example, before Stella was talking about the fact that the internet is very useful when you want to share your writings. In fact, I also share my book are entirely online. So what we do like to do with the internet, with the digital tools, we want to share knowledge and we want to share the things we write for other people to rewrite and reshare. So I prefer to choose technologies that are not proprietary, that are easy to copy and paste. That, for example, I prefer to publish my book as HTML, like here, instead of PDF, because here you can copy and paste, you can never take the whole book and change the format. In a PDF, you can't, because the PDF is closed in a specific format. So again, the question is, what do we like to do with this tool? And if we can do the same thing with the convivial technologies. So here I'm asking you to write down what you like to do with your favorite app and platform. But we can even take it from what you already wrote. Like someone likes to do collaborative writing. Someone likes to reach many people and verbosity. Someone likes to know that it's in a secure environment. Someone likes to communicate with elite people. So can we do all these things, the things that we like, that we like to do? What can we do these things with the convivial technologies? Let's see, because this is very interesting, because of course what we can't do with the convivial technology, we have to do to use technologies of domination. But we can even develop new technologies, because there are coders and creators and hackers that can imagine and write new technology. And I'm sure there are many also among you that are following now this webinar. So let's see in these minutes that are left some practical tools that we can use for doing what we do like to do. I made a list of tools for doing the things that we like to do, or that I usually like to do, because I just met you now, so I didn't know what you do like to do. But luckily enough, we are almost on the same boat. So there is also something about how to be aware of what you do on social media when you want to do a campaign. And on this, Stella can add something from her experience. But I will go on this after, because first I would like to see the tools that we can use. Okay, these tools that I'm listing are available on the pod. The links are all here. And these tools are, for example, social media platform that doesn't belong to technologies of domination, because they are distributed and federated, and they are not owned by a central authority. The tagline of Mastodon says social networking that's not for sale. You can even install your Mastodon server in your own community. And the Mastodon is growing. Of course, it doesn't have the numbers of Facebook or Twitter, but it's actually growing up very, very much. And then you can experiment with that a lot. We can even follow up if you have questions in the chat later, and I can follow you in any thing you may need to approach other technologies. This is very interesting. You may not know it at all, Gancho, because it's, you know, the Facebook events, no? People say, me as a first people say, okay, I'm going to organize an event like a demonstration or a concert or whatever, but if I don't publish it on Facebook, no one will see it and I will have no people. So what can I do? And a group of hackers from the north of Italy, from Turin, from an hack club in Turin, they wrote down this tool, which is called Gancho, and it's a shared calendar where everyone can add here. This is in Italian, but there are also English instances. You can add your event. You add the title, the name, all the settings, you describe it, and then you can find it on the common calendar. You can decide which calendar to export, on which kind of events by tag, so feminist event, music events, activist events, or whatever. And the interesting thing is that you can install this code on your own server and make a local server for local communities. So right now, Gancho is in many cities in Italy, because after Turin, some people made it in Rome, some people made it in the south of Italy, some people made it in other countries in Europe. And here you can find eccolo qua, to install Gancho, and the link also to install a local instance, because it's convivial technology, so the code is open and you can implement, use it, and all the links are available here. This is another similar project, but it's funny because these projects, they are based on RSS feed, which is something that the current technologies left in the past, but we believe that evolution in technology may have taken different paths. So instead of using the algorithm of the social media, we may keep using and using a different way the RSS feed that they've been using in the 90s and 20 years ago. And this is an aggregator blob, it's called. It's an aggregator for blog post, for website post, and you can see it following different tags, so you can decide to see everything about strikes, and you see the post of the communities related to strikes. And also we have okay, I can go on talking a lot of each of those, but you find them in the link, also in English, so you can dig deeper on your own. Another interesting tool is PeerTube, which is an alternative to YouTube, basically. This is on a French organization, which is called Framasoft. They develop convivial technologies, we can say. The nice thing of PeerTube is that it's a decentralized network. It means that there is not a central server, but the video are shared on all the different nodes of the network. For example, this is okay, PeerTube Lecos. Okay, this is how PeerTube appears. And you can even choose to install PeerTube on your own server and use it for your community. So the interesting thing of these technologies is that they can scale, they can be useful for your local community, and they can even scale on bigger communities. So they can, you can start by using it for the people you relate also physically with, and then you can scale to a bigger public. Also to organize and collaborate, there is Nextcloud, which is Google Cloud, but it's independent cloud that has the characteristic of a convivial technologies, because it's it takes care of your privacy, and it's the code there is a community developing it, so it doesn't belong to an owner. There are many pubs, the pub that we just saw, there are many, and you can see them on the here in the list of the link here, list of instances of the pub. And you can also use protected text, which is a kind of pub that is encrypted. So if you want to be sure that no one that anyone that is not part of your community shouldn't read what you're writing, because it's sensitive information, you can use protected text. There are also other kind of protected and encrypted pub. This is one of those I choose to put you in the list, to put for you in the list of tools. Then I will take just other 5 minutes to talk a moment about social creative activism on social media. And please, Stella, you are welcome to add your experience on that. Because the social media platform, as you may realize, it doesn't belong to you. So they can shut you down. They can close your profile, they can obscure you. You write, but no one gets your messages delivered. It's called the shadow ban. It happens on all the digital platforms that are not owned by you or by other collectives. So you have to know that. And also you have to know that it's not easy to become viral. It may happen, but it may not, especially if you're not given the visibility you deserve. So what is important to do when you do an action using social media? It's important that you create a website where you collect all the things that you are communicating on the social media profile. This is why if they will shut down your account, you are not going to lose all your pictures and texts. In fact, this happens often in Italy, in the north of Italy. Pages from activist spaces have been shut down with easy reason, like contents that were not okay with the policy of the platform. But there are the platform, I always find good reason to shut you down. So it's important that you save everything. And it's important that you create a website from where you take the material that you put on your page. Here there is a link to noblogs.org, which is an Italian community of hackers that offers, also in English, offers spaces to create blogs. So if you want to create your own website, but you don't know where to start, you can ask to noblogs, to the AI collective for a space for to run a blog. They will set up everything. It's in the list of things in the pub. Another important thing is that you may want to automate the posting, like from your website, from your blog, you automate the posting with the RSS feed to feed the social media account so that you don't ever need to spend time on the social media. The bot will do the work for you and the words will be spreaded. Of course, this all depends on the kind of campaign you want to run. And of course, make a backup of your contacts. If they close down your account or your page, you risk to lose thousands of contacts. So it's important that you find a way to keep track of your contact and create a parallel place where you have all the important contacts. Facebook says that you can make a backup of the contact, but it's not true. I did it and it just doesn't work. It's broken. And I don't think they have any interest in making it work because they want to keep you there. Unless they shut you down if you're not complying with them. And okay, that's all on the good practices when you want to start a social media campaign. Of course, there are many other things that experts like Stella can add from her experience. Last thing, before to open last minutes to some question and answer, is that the attitude that is important for me, for us to have, is to open and transform the device. To consider that inside every black box, there is always a computer that can be opened, profaned. And you can change the way it functions. For example, in this image, we see this very nice action that took place in Brussels some years ago. The billboard, the digital billboard, have been hacked and they published a pad where everyone in the street was able to write. So this was really, really fun to me. I was not there, but I think it's very, very interesting because it's a way to make a public space public again. So, okay, this is my invite to experiment and always be aware of the technology you use. Use whatever you need to use for your for the things you want to do, but be aware of the way in which it works. And on the pad, you find all the links of the things that we are talking about and even something else. So I would like to open the space, and this is last 5 minutes to you for questions or comments. And also Stella, please, if you have something to add, you are mostly welcome because you have much more experience with social media campaigns. So you are really welcome if you want to add your comment. Thank you very much. And I stop the sharing to see if there are questions. Ah, okay. My God, there are many things in the chat. Okay, John, Daniana says that Garam John has been jailed because of suspicion. Ah, okay. Thank you for the sharing. Okay, it's back up your contacts. Okay, so if there are not any questions, I want to thank you all very, very much for being with us in these 2 hours. I hope I gave you some interesting suggestions to think about. You may even write your questions on the pad. Ah, okay, there is that. Sorry, that I didn't see. You're welcome to talk.
Well, Thank you so much. My name is Dutan Rikulang from Youth Empowerment Foundation. Mine is not a question, it's just a word of thanks. Thank you for the book you gave to William on technology and some stuff. I actually read it, it was educative. Thank you so much for handing it over to him. I also enjoyed the session.
Thank you very much, Dat. I'm really glad that you did enjoy the book. It's nice because it has been traveling from Italy to Germany and from Germany to Uganda. So I really love the physical copies traveling all around the world. And the book is also available online at this address, which is also in the pad. So for those of you who are not in the AskNet hub, you can find the book online, which is very important to share everything. Thank you very much, Dat, for your words. Anyone else? There is someone in the chat. Thank you, Daniana. I'm really glad that you appreciate. Thank you for the feedback. It's really appreciated. And if there are no more things, anyway, we will keep in touch in the Telegram chat or the pad, and we will be, me and Sabina, we will be happy to keep collaborating and sharing the tools and links we know with you. And most of all, of course, I want to say thank you to Rogue Agency, to RogueNet, and to Rogue Agency, and to AskNet, to Yara for hosting the webinar, and to Stefan for being with us. And of course, I really want to thank you, Stella Nianzi, for her really empowering presentation and for sharing her experience. And please keep fighting and whatever we can do for helping. If you want to develop a website, need any help or whatever, we have each other contacts and we will, we are here. So thank you very much to Sabina too and to everyone.